So we're moving on to a section now around, it's a third section of session of today called Divesting of Orphanage Tourism. And the aim of this session is to recognise orphanage volunteering as a significant driver of institutional care. We'll explore the harm caused by orphanage volunteering through the perspectives of both evidence and direct experience, and in doing so, make the case for divestment. One of the ways we'll do this is by refocusing the conversation on the experience of children themselves who have been subject to orphanage tourism. It's therefore with great pleasure that I'd like to introduce you to our first speaker in this session, Ruth Wacuka. Ruth describes herself as a proud Kenyan whose life experience has informed her professional career as a speaker, change maker, and consultant. Her focus is on ensuring that the lived experience of children and young people affected by care is not only heard, but is part of decisions around policy and programming. She is also passionate about redirecting voluntourism towards community and family-based initiatives. Ruth uses her voice and various platforms to advocate for issues around identity, culture, and justice, especially for young people. She consults, she's founded her own organization called Reroot Africa, and she's a recognized speaker in international fora. Yet Ruth says she's always proud to be called a Kenyan and to call Kenya her home. Welcome, Ruth, over to you.
Dear Ruth, your speech at the 1 year mark on orphanage tourism was a great one. I would love you to speak to my 19-year-old son about the same as he plans a group trip to a Kenyan orphanage for 2 weeks volunteer work. This was an opening message I received 1 week after coming back from participating in the launching of a beautiful campaign against orphanage tourism in United Kingdom in 2019. It was not a new case. The world is full of generous people, you know, people who want to see solutions, and many of us are natural problem solvers, and we look for ways that we can help others and address the world's problems with our time and resources. I knew very well to expect a message like this. That was not surprising. But what was surprising is that I received messages as these, not just from the United States and the UK, but also from my own neighborhood, Nairobi, where young, energetic, and visionary youth were also wanting to be engaged. This came as a reminder that in the past, this was actually me on the receiving end of a high, you know, well-intended action from a not so well-informed group of people. But then I was in the confinement of a highly world orphanage I called home for years of my childhood. To me, this was an opportunity, and a fantastic opportunity to redirect and not retreat. It is very common for tourists to visit orphanages as part of sightseeing and volunteering projects. And for some students, a volunteering experience is part of their education. You know, a visit to the orphanage would include playing games, holding babies, delivering a lesson, or bathing children. I know that not all volunteers engage in these activities in all orphanages, but they did in the orphanage where I grew up. And the day before our home received visitors, it was more of a music or drama festival. And in a home that doubled up as a school, the lessons would be suspended to dedicate the day for preparation. Children would be excited, and everyone would want to just guess what group was to come. You see, we knew a majority of the groups, especially from Australia and the United States. And we even knew what they would do upon arrival sometimes. We knew what gifts they would bring. The majority of children had created very strong bonds with tourists from the volunteer groups who eventually turned into personal friends, especially for those that would not or would live with us for some weeks or months to end. And for those who did not still have friends, it was their time to just work hard even more the next time to create a friend during the next group visit. And if that failed too, there was always a next time, and at least in our minds. We would sing, we would dance. And the most religious songs were reserved for such a time as this, and most sentimental poems would carry the day. What gifted, beautiful impression orphaned babies, heavy British accent would follow with a donation. A speech from the management would follow, and later everyone would disperse. It was a time for teachers to mark assignments, and the house mothers to rest, and also for children to enjoy their time with their visitors. Yet, as happy as that sounds, I ask all of you here today, how many parents here would allow their children unsupervised moments with a stranger? I am happy for my peers who later in life got their happily ever after born from moments that were not supervised alongside foreign visitors. However, my heart remains cold for those who had the opposite experience and bear the arms of untold stories. The last activity of the day usually was, you know, a meeting under a tree where the management would sit with the visitors. And on some occasions, they would drive off to a hotel in the neighborhood. To an observer, of course, you would think this scene at a face value, because the normalcy is that happy faces equals happy people. However, if you looked very close, you would observe that the children were in tattered clothes, while the director ate at fancy restaurants, right? And whilst our needs were unmet in this orphanage, the home kept taking new children and garnered more funds, but the children's conditions remained poor. While tourists usually believe that they are doing a good thing, and by visiting or giving a donation, they'll believe that children will ultimately get the best care they need. But however, children are deliberately kept in poor conditions in order to encourage higher donations. And advantageously, this contributes to a situation that pushes more children to institutions. But isn't it interesting? The day we were taken home, we spent a night in a lodge where the owners had children in my orphanage, right? The father was made to believe that he was sending his children to a boarding school. And what parent does not want quality education for their kids? My beautiful country, Kenya, is famed for its scenic landscape and vast wildlife. And many tourists will go to the extremes to experience the beauty of this country. And for the preserved majority, elephants, giraffes, and rhinos are a must-see while visiting Kenya. The global tourism shows that in 2019, Kenya received 2.03 million tourists. But what these numbers do not tell us is how many of these tourists actually visited orphanages in addition to wildlife on the beach. The majority of care experienced people who have continued to lack, you know, I struggle with the lack of social connection, mentors, friendships, identity, and belonging. But many times people will ask, didn't you ever make friends while at the orphanage? Or haven't you made friends after exit? But it's not because of the absence of people while growing up, but it's a result of a thousand prints in their lives that were never permanent. Because there's always a next time moment, sadly, was never to be, and the struggle to belonging continues. And no wonder Brené Brown quotes and says that even in the context of suffering, poverty, violence, human rights violations, not belonging to our families is still one of the most dangerous parts. That is because it has the power to break our heart, our spirit, and our sense of worth. And after all, social connections are crafts and skills gained and learned in the community and not orphanages, which is an opportunity that many caregivers were denied. While orphanage tourism, of course, fosters child abuse and exploitation, the resources used in this project have the potential to achieve the maximum if redirected towards family-based care. And after all, the families equals justice for children who need care and protection. I rewrote Africa, which was born out of my experience in orphanage tourism and volunteering, is working with volunteer groups to ensure that they are informed enough to make a decision. And in many cases, we have ended up redirecting these resources, community-based care, because we are confident that it's a responsible thing to do and a responsible place for a child to be before we should do more. But in the meantime, I am just wondering that how much more could we achieve if all join hands and work together, especially with the government, the church, the tourism agencies, the policymakers, care reform advocates, the prospective travelers, the volunteers. But even, what if we had a policy restricting orphanage tourism? A great step was for the UK government in discouraging tourism orphanage visits with a travel advisory in 2019. It's also equally a very historic moment for my country, Kenya, that the government is working towards phasing out institutional care, which ultimately eradicates orphanage tourism. But until then, what are we, you and I, doing in our spheres of influence? Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie, a Nigerian writer I so adore, warns us about the dangers of a single story and the potential it has in creating stereotypes. She continues to explain that the problem with stereotypes is that they are untrue. It's not that they are untrue, but they are incomplete. They make one story become the only story. And so as a former recipient, service recipient, my orphanage tourism experience is my story, but not the only story. Let's learn from Asia, let's learn from other African countries, let's learn from Australia, Eastern Europe, etc. And as part of these, that we need to be at the starting point of making vulnerable children recipients of justice and not of charity. And I want to end by quoting Benjamin Franklin, that justice will not be served until those who are unaffected are as outraged as those who are. Thank you.
Wow, Ruth, that's a powerful presentation. Even though I've worked in this area for many years, just hearing you say that orphanages are part of sightseeing tours still shocks me. It just sounds so crazy that is allowed. And then you talk about lessons being suspended so that the children can be there for the tourists as part of a show for tourists, really highlights the way that children are being objectified through this process of orphanage tourism. I think you also really highlighted well the safeguarding risks around allowing unsupervised visitors to have access to children in orphanages and institutions. And you also highlighted the way children are being exploited when you talked about the director driving off to a fancy restaurant to eat nice food while the children's conditions were being kept deliberately poor for the sole reason that that's the way to elicit higher donations from the tourists, that really emphasizes why this is a form of trafficking. Let's call it what it is. It is trafficking. But I think most of all, when you talk about the greatest human rights violation is that children are not allowed to belong to a family. That's at the heart of this problem. And that's what we really, really need to change. And if we could solve that, we could solve this problem. So thank you so much, Ruth, for sharing your heartfelt story and your thoughts on this. Much appreciated. We're gonna move on to our second speaker in this session now. So I'd like you to introduce you to Sinet Chan. Sinet is a human rights activist, a scriptwriter, and a director on the board of the Cambodian Children's Trust. Sinet's story has garnered international media attention, which led to an invitation to testify at the Australian Parliamentary Inquiry into Modern Slavery in 2017. In 2021, Sinet was selected as one of 16 young leaders from around the world to serve as a member of USAID's Centre on Children in Adversity Council. She is currently working with the Cambodian Children's Trust to build a national support network for care leavers called Kamina Onka Cambodia. In 2018, Sinet scripted the television series One Mission and the Khmer TV drama series Shrotun Munsni. Apologies if I've not pronounced that correctly. She also wrote and directed the short film Because I Love You More, which received a nomination at the 2019 Cambodian Chattamook Short Film Festival. In 2019, the United Nations Development Programme selected Sinet as an up-and-coming media entrepreneur, inspiring the future of Cambodia's media industry. It's a great pleasure to have you here, Sinet. Over to you.
Hello, everyone. My name is Sinet. I was born in Bat Dambong, Cambodia. My family was very poor and my parents were sick with HIV. After my mother and father died from AIDS, I was separated from my older brothers and community I live in and sent to live in an orphanage with my older sister and my younger brothers. When I first arrived at the orphanage, I thought it might be a good opportunity for me. It was funded by the foreigners, and so I thought maybe this orphanage could have given me good opportunity for my life. At the age of 10 years old, I was excited to finally start school. Soon after arriving at the orphanage, I began to feel very unsafe. The other children and I were badly neglected. Foreigners, donors visited regularly and donated money, but we were never had enough to eat. Mostly, we ate the leftover food sent to us from the monastery. But someday, we would have to find our own food. We would catch mice, frogs, and patch waste from the fields surrounding the orphanage, or pick wild morning glory alongside nearby waterways. We also never received medical treatment when we were sick. My older sister was diagnosed with HIV and her health declined rapidly living in the orphanage. I worry about her a lot. Under the guise of giving us life skill, we were also made to work every morning and evening doing hard manual labor on the land owned by director of the orphanage. The director also used to abuse us. My younger brother was beaten and lashed on many occasions. And I was raped for many years. The director threatened to kill me if I ever told anyone. I lived in fear and was scared all the time. During this time, we had many volunteers and donors coming and going. We would always entertain them, singing them a song and playing games with them to encourage them to donate money. When I was younger, living in an orphanage, I just thought of this as a means of survival. The volunteers were nice people trying to help us. But now I realize it was a form of exploitation, using our children to generate funding. Even though my sibling and I had lost both of our parents, we were missed the rest of our family a lot. All the other children in orphanage still had parents who were alive and they missed their family too. All the coming and going of the volunteers and visitors then compounded our feeling of loss and abandonment. The love and affection we received from the visitor initially feel nice. Some visitor and volunteer would come for one day, some for a few weeks, and some for 6 months or more. It was always very traumatic when it's come time for them to leave. We would be very upset and cry a lot. I think it triggered memory of the loss and separation we had all suffered already. And so having adult coming in and out of our life feel like we were continually being abandoned. They would always say they were coming back, but they never come back. I think the uncomfortable truth behind the reason why white people feel like they need to participate in voluntarism is they have a white savior complex. The white savior complex is caused by the unconscious belief in the incompetence of the people they are trying to help. That belief justify why they feel they must come and do it for us, like building our house, digging our wells, save our children. The truth is, we have all the ability required to solve our problem. We just lack the resource to action our own solution. Will our solution look different to how you would do in the West? Yes, but that is okay. West is not necessarily best. So in order to combat voluntarism, white people must examine their unconscious bias and learn how to be a white ally instead of a white saver. A white ally acknowledges the harm of white saverism and use their white privilege to actively deconstruct system of inequality and oppression. An ally believes in resourcing, empowering, and giving platform to people like me so we can shape our own future. Thank you.
Welcome back, everybody. I hope you enjoyed the breakout rooms. Now it's time for our final part of our session on divesting of orphanage tourism. And we're honored to have with us Tim Millikan from the Australian Embassy in Dublin. So welcome, Tim. We're really, really happy to have you here today. Thank you for giving up your time and your busy schedule to come to this event. Much appreciated. But before I hand over to Tim, I want to briefly hand back to Sinet, who's going to say a few words about the Australian Modern Slavery Act inquiry, which will put Tim's speech in context. So over to you, Sinet.
In January 2016, a senator from Australia, Senator Linda Reynolds, visited Cambodia as a part of Save the Children advocacy trip to promote Australia Aid Program. During that trip, colleagues from Rethinking Orphanage Australia arranged for the parliamentary to learn about the issues of child institutionalization and orphanage tourism and volunteering. I had the opportunity to meet with the senator during the visit, and after learning about the range of issues linked to orphanage volunteering and outcome for children in Cambodia institution, the senator asked me, what can I do about this? I said to the Senator Reynolds, please tell the Australian people not to volunteer or send money to orphanages in Cambodia because it is causing harm. When Senator Reynolds returned to Australia, she began speaking up about this issue in the parliament and other government forum. Member of Rethinking Orphanage Australia connected with her and began to collaborate to curb Australia's involvement in orphanage volunteering, tourism, and funding of overseas orphanages. Early in 2017, Australia launched an inquiry into establishment of a Modern Slavery Act. And Senator Reynolds was appointed to the parliamentary committee overseeing the inquiry. Rethinking Orphanage members worked with Senator Reynolds to ensure that orphanage tourism and trafficking were included in the inquiry scope. This effort were successful, and orphanage tourism, trafficking, and the funding of unlawfully operating institution was formally examined by the committee. I was invited to go to Australia to give expert witness in front of the committee as a part of the inquiry. I am delighted that we have Mr. Tim Millikan, Deputy Head of Mission at the Australian Embassy in Ireland, to speak more about the step Australia took to combat this issue.
Thank you so much, Sinet. And I know we're going to hear from Tim now about the effect that your interventions and your work and many other people's work had on the introduction of the Australian Modern Slavery Act. So I'd like to introduce Tim to you. Tim is a career officer with the Australian Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade. He's served in Port Louis in Mauritius, Brasilia in Brazil, Accra in Ghana, including being the acting High Commissioner for some time in Ghana, and has also served on shorter assignments in Bougainville as part of the Peace Monitoring Group, in Afghanistan as part of the International Security Assistance Force, and Harare in Zimbabwe, Pretoria in South Africa, and Ankara in Turkey. Tim is currently posted to Dublin as Deputy Head of Mission and Consul, a role he commenced in September 2019. His current role includes reporting on developments in Ireland, helping promote a modern and positive image of Australia, and assisting Australians in Ireland affected by COVID. Over to you, Tim. It's a pleasure to have you here. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. And Martin and Sinet, thank you for your very kind introductions. I've been listening on and off this morning, and I feel much better informed than I did at 9 o'clock this morning from tuning in. So it's been explained, I'm an Australian public servant and in the Australian Diplomatic Corps. And what this typically means is that, and certainly does today, is that I'm not an expert in the areas under discussion, but I'm pretty good at research, responding to requests, and I've got a whole organisation I can reach back to try and get the information. So building what I've heard this morning, my plan is to try and talk about two key areas of work in Australia relating to children in institutional care. So the first area is the Australian Parliamentary Inquiry into Children in Institutional Care, which took place from 2003 to 2005. The Senate Community Affairs Reference Committee that conducted the inquiry received over 500 written submissions and conducted hearings over 8 days across the whole of Australia. Now, all the information about this inquiry, including all the public submissions, the public hearings, the reports, and the government response, can be found on the Australian Parliament's homepage, which is aph.gov.au. Now, the committee produced two reports. The first report, and I'm using two screens, so bear with me. There we go. The first two reports, Forgotten Australians, a report on Australians who experienced institutional or out-of-home care as children, and the second report, Protecting Vulnerable Children, a National Challenge. Now, the work of the committee and its reports were important to understanding what was going on in Australia, what damaging practices were occurring, and what might be done to change this. So the first report states that the duty of care was lacking in several fundamental areas in relation to children and institutional care. So in respect of adequate provision of the basic needs of children, that is adequate food, clothing, and nurture. But the report also acknowledged the horrendous levels of physical, sexual, and emotional abuse that were allowed to occur while these children were in care. And equally disturbing is the fact that such abuse was able to continue unchecked over so many years. And for those who know Australia, we have three levels of government to make it extra challenging for us. So the report states that while Australia's federal government was not directly involved in the administration of these institutions, it has a moral obligation to acknowledge the harm done to so many children and fellow Australians in institutional care settings. An acknowledgement of those terms, of these terms, will be an important part of the healing and reconciliation process for many care leavers. So the Australian government, in its response to the first report, acknowledged that all levels of government have responsibility for the well-being of Australian children, all children have a right to care and protection, and that all children deserve love and support. And the policies that allowed these outrages to be perpetrated on innocent children were not only misplaced, They're inexcusable in any era. So the report produced 39 recommendations. Many deal with different aspects of the need for research and training in child protection related issues. And I'm pleased to say there are now a range of academic and vocational training courses in the child protection area available in Australia. For the second report, with its focus more on contemporary child protection and welfare issues, the report makes some recommendations that will assist governments in developing a child welfare and protection framework that is capable of providing a safe and caring environment for children and young people and protecting their rights, including their right to their cultural heritage. I should say that this came after the back of another inquiry into the stolen generation, which was the practice of forcibly removing some Aboriginal children from their parents. So that sort of predates this, and this predates the committee that Sinet referred to. So we accept that the safety and welfare of children is the responsibility of all Australians, governments, communities, families, and individuals. And it is the responsibility of all to ensure that the system works effectively for children and their families. So in the second report ended up with 18 recommendations on how to achieve this. Now, these reports led to a national apology in November 2009, a public admission of all the wrongs done in the past, and a commitment for all Australians to work towards ensuring change. Now, this provides, I guess, a nice segue into the next area of work I want to speak about, which is an example of how recommendations from parliamentary committees translate into policy. So the second topic I'm going to speak about is called the Smart Volunteering Campaign. And again, there's a whole suite of information about the Smart Volunteering Campaign available online at the Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade website, dfat.gov.au. Okay, so Australia has a long and proud history of volunteering. For decades, thousands of Australians from all backgrounds have given their time and skills selflessly to help communities overseas. And the work of our volunteers builds skills and supports economic growth in developing countries. However, we are aware that some Australians' volunteers have unwittingly contributed to harmful practices by participating in volunteerism industry and engaging in orphanage tourism. That's all right, I've just lost my page. Give me one sec. So we've already discussed today by several speakers, research has shown that orphanage tourism, and which I really mean holiday tours and short-term unskilled volunteering in orphanages, can encourage harmful practices and can, in some cases, put vulnerable children at risk. So in March 2018, the Australian government launched a campaign to prevent Australians from inadvertently contributing to child exploitation through the practice of orphanage tourism, including by participating in misleading volunteer programs. So this is called the Smart Volunteering Campaign. Let me just not lose my place again. So as part of the campaign, we are explaining to volunteers that the number of orphanage in certain popular tourist destinations has increased dramatically. Yet many of the children living in them have at least one living parent. The quality of care varies dramatically, and that the worst orphanages retain and exploit children with the aim of making money. Orphanage should be an option of last resort for children who are generally better off living with their families and communities. So the Smart Volunteering Campaign discourages Australians from any form of short-term unskilled volunteering at overseas orphanages. So the Australian government's developed a checklist to assist Australians or anyone else who wants to use it to be a smart volunteer in their volunteer activities overseas. So it's designed to articulate clearly the negative impacts of orphanage tourism, but also equip potential volunteers to make an informed choice about how and where they volunteer. Because we don't want to discourage volunteering. We want volunteers to make informed choices that result in rewarding outcomes for both the volunteer and the recipient organisation or community. So the Smart Volunteering Campaign encourages Australians planning to volunteer overseas to consider three main points: to be an informed volunteer, to be a child safe volunteer, and to be a prepared volunteer. So let's unpack these slightly. When we talk about being an informed volunteer, we want to encourage volunteers to look into the sector they're considering and understand how it works. So the campaign specifically states that the Australian government discourages any form of short-term unskilled volunteering in orphanages. And the reason for this is constant strangers coming in and out of children's lives can be harmful to a child's development. Some orphanages are created to get money from tourists rather than provide care to children, and that this can encourage an over-reliance on orphanage care, separate families, and may put vulnerable children at greater risk of harm. So then we want, you know, volunteers to be child-safe volunteers. So we want volunteers to consider how their volunteer activities might impact children. So the campaign states that we want volunteers to avoid any activity where children are promoted as tourist attractions. So care for vulnerable children should aim to reintegrate children into their family or community settings where it is safe to do so. Volunteers should thoroughly research any overseas organisation offering opportunities to volunteer with children to check they're acting in the best interests of the children. And finally, they should find out if the organisation has a child protection policy and how it is put into practice. And the third point is to be a prepared volunteer. So this is where the campaign seeks to direct volunteers into appropriate activities. It calls on volunteers to be a smart volunteer when you are overseas. And so the main points are going to be your activities as a volunteer should do no harm and address a need in a local community. We want volunteers to do their homework to make sure they are the right person for the right organisation, making a positive contribution to the community. We also want them to find out any country-specific advice, requirements or restrictions on volunteering activities. And I guess the other important lesson we have learned that if you want to encourage a particular course of action, you need to make it as easy as possible to do so. So in providing the campaign and online resources, we've provided some additional questions to help potential volunteers organize their thoughts. So just quickly, we want people to say, is the organization they're considering trustworthy, transparent, and reputable? What can you learn about their mission and financial information from their website and or other independent materials? Does it have a proven track record? Does it comply with the laws and regulations of the country where you will be a volunteer? The next question is volunteering actually the right fit for you in your travel? Have you been given clear information about what activities you will be doing as a volunteer? Do you have the right skills and experience to do the proposed activities? And will you be sharing your skills with local staff? And the third and most important one really in some respects is the organisation child safe? Do they have a child protection policy? Are volunteers asked to read and sign a code of conduct, which includes guidance on their child protection policy and procedures?
Thank you. In this next session that we're going to move on to now, we're going to also break you up into groups, and we're going to look at four different thematic areas and introduce you to four different expert speakers that we have the pleasure of having with us today. And in this session, what we're going to look at is practical examples of pioneering change with respect to these issues. We're going to see looked at the issues of support of institutional care, volunteering and tourism.
And so the
these raise a lot of questions about how do you do this?
To help volunteers select NGOs that have appropriate policies and practices in place.
faith is a huge motivating
force. So Australia's Department for Foreign Affairs and Trade publishes an online list of non-government organisations accredited to the Department's NGO cooperation program. So these are NGOs that have been through our checks. We know they've got child protection policies in place. We know they've got well-considered, well-developed development programs to actually assist in meaningful ways. The next organisation is the Australian Council for International Development. It publishes a list of NGOs that are signatories to its code of conduct, which include child protection and standards. And finally,
welcome
the Australian
back,
Volunteer
everybody.
Program, run by the Australian Government.
I hope you enjoyed the breakout rooms. I hope you found the presentation useful, and I hope you had a chance to ask some questions online. And got
clearly
some,
these
got some
are
answers
opportunities
to your
and activities
well.
Which have met our standards and which will actually be helpful to children and not harmful. So I'm going to leave it there. I hope that gives you a good sense of some of the ways Australia is approaching children and institutional care and how we are working to discourage orphanage tourism. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Tim. Thank you for that presentation. Thank you for unpacking some of the fantastic initiatives of the Australian government and presenting that case study. Australia has most definitely demonstrated commendable leadership in this area around advocating for changing practices and ethical practices in volunteering, both domestically in Australia, but really taken a strong leadership position on the global stage around this issue as well. So thank you so much for your contribution and your time to be with us today. We really appreciate that, and it's been very insightful. So thank you.
My absolute pleasure.